Order. Are there any questions? Call the Leader of the Opposition.
Speaker, my question's to the Minister for Health. At 2 days of age, Amelia had her first open heart surgery and her parents were told she'd require further surgery within months. Amelia was scheduled for surgery on July 17, but the day before it was cancelled due to a lack of intensive care beds. Rescheduled for July 25, but having gone through extensive pre-op preparation, an hour prior to surgery, it was cancelled again. This young girl's serious health condition is deteriorating. What does the Minister have to say to Amelia's parents who are devastated with having to watch their young daughter, her health deteriorate to such an extent that she'll become so sick? The only way to get vital surgery is for it to become emergency surgery when her life is then at risk.
Minister for Health. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I thank the Leader of the Opposition for his question. Can I begin by acknowledging how challenging this is for Amelia and her family at this time? Every parent knows how hard it is to see a child that is sick or in pain and in need of healthcare. But what I want to assure Amelia's parents and indeed all Victorians is that decisions about planned surgery are being made and managed every single day in our health system with the care of all patients in mind at all time. I also want to make this point. Right now in Victoria, indeed right around our nation and across the globe, health services have been incredibly impacted by the COVID pandemic. Now, what we have seen is a winter. Winters are always hard in the health system, but on top of that, this year we've had to manage another wave of the coronavirus. What that means and where it has the most significant impact is on the staff that are available on any given day to provide the care that is needed. We know that on any day between 1,500 and 2,000 of our hardworking healthcare workers are furloughed because they have COVID. And this, of course, does not take into account the many healthcare workers who are at home caring on carer's leave or sick or other planned or unplanned leave. So this is what is having an impact. So again, I want to assure Amelia's parents that our government absolutely understands their concern and their worry at this time. But I also want to assure her parents that we have one of the best health services here in Victoria. And when it comes to the care of children, here in Victoria, we're acknowledged globally for being world leaders. Now, we know that these challenges are real and that they're being experienced every day. That's why our government has a $12 billion pandemic repair plan, and we are implementing that plan now. We know that it's healthcare workers that will help get our system back on track. That's why we've got a plan to train or recruit an additional 7,000 healthcare workers. That's why in the past two years, we have employed 8,500 additional healthcare workers. So only a couple of weeks ago, Speaker, the Premier and I were out announcing some further initiatives that are driving down or focused on driving down the demand in our system and ensuring that children like Amelia and indeed all of those on waiting lists can get the care that they need and deserve.
On a supplementary question, the Leader of the Opposition.
I do thank the Minister for her answer, but note that Amelia's surgery has twice been cancelled due to a lack of intensive care beds. So I ask the Minister, when will the 4,000 intensive care beds that the Premier promised in April 2020 actually be delivered?
Minister for Health.
Thank you very much, and I thank the Member for his supplementary question, and I make this point. It's not a bed that cares for children, it's nurses, doctors, clinicians, and right now, more than 1,500 hardworking healthcare workers are at home, furloughed with COVID. So we expect, as we see the virus continue to or plateau and then trend down, that we will see more healthcare workers back in the system. Once again, I want to assure Amelia's parents that every person, every child and every person on our planned surgery list is being actively managed by the healthcare service, so that Amelia's parents can expect to be contacted by the healthcare service, and they will support her and her family through this really difficult time.
Order. Member for Warrandyte. On the Minister's statement, I call the Premier.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I'm delighted to be able to update the House on the fact that this year alone, the government, in partnership with Ambulance Victoria, has recruited some 404 new ambulance paramedics. 157 of those are destined for regional Victoria. This is a very strong recruitment performance and builds on last year, the biggest ever year of paramedic recruitment, more than 700 new ambulance paramedics recruited last year. Yes, that's right. As my honourable friend, the Minister, member for Frankston, points out, we're not going to war with our paramedics. We're instead recruiting lots of them, respecting them, listening to them, valuing them, and they in turn are working so very hard for every single Victorian. Last year was the biggest year ever in recruitment, but we had more than 700 extra paramedics. This year we are set, year to date, we project that we will recruit even more than the biggest ever year last year, so even more than 700 paramedics. Speaker, I know you'll be pleased to know that 157 of those are going to regional Victoria. For instance, 26 paramedics will be joining the Bowen South West region, 23 in Gippsland, 24 in Grampians Ballarat, 50 in Hume, central and northern regions, 34 in Loddon, Mallee and Bendigo. So right across regional Victoria, more paramedics. Right across metropolitan Melbourne, more ambulance paramedics, with the equipment, with the resources, with the budget, with the support and respect of our government, something that they've not always had from others. We back our paramedics to keep doing the work they do, saving lives, changing lives, and that's why we're very proud to be able to say we have increased from 43 paramedics per 100,000 Victorians to 56 paramedics per 100,000 Victorians, and not by good luck, but by strong investment and consistent support and an abiding respect, as they are highly skilled and highly effective professionals.
Leader of the Opposition.
Speaker, my question is again to the Minister for Health. Yesterday, on Monday evening at the Royal Children's Hospital, they couldn't manage patient demand, with families forced to wait outside in the rain for up to 9 hours. Some of the children waiting to be seen were as young as 9 months old. What immediate action has the Minister taken to ensure that kids won't continue to wait outside, particularly in the rain, and the kids who present at the Children's Hospital will be seen immediately?
Call the Minister for Health.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I thank the Leader of the Opposition for his question. During the winter break, I had the opportunity to visit many of our healthcare services, and it was fantastic to go and see the Children's Hospital in action and to understand the way in which they care for children who present on any given day. And what was great to see is how they have their own triaging system in emergency to make sure that they can turn around children as quickly as possible who might present with little cuts and bruises and so on. So that was great to see. But of course, when we're talking about children that really need that urgent care, these are decisions, active decisions, that are made by our hard-working healthcare workers. They are being triaged by paramedics. They are being triaged by clinicians. At every step of the way, the children that present to the Royal Children's Hospital are being cared for. Now, I want to make the point that I absolutely understand the discomfort that may be experienced, and indeed how, and once again, how stressful it can be as a parent, because in that situation, what you want is for your child to be seen first and foremost. But that's why we have clinicians in place, and their job is to assess every child on their acuity and to deliver care according to that. So this is a responsibility that our health services take very, very seriously, and certainly as Health Minister, it is something that I take very seriously.
On a point of order, the member for Ripon.
Thank you, Speaker. The question asked what immediate action had the minister taken in relation to the specific instance that was raised. So, on relevance, I ask you to answer the question. Get her to answer the question.
Question related to potential demand for children waiting, and I think the minister is being relevant to the question that was asked.
Thank you, Speaker, and I thank the member for their question. I make this point. The caseload at a hospital like the Children's varies hour to hour, day to day, and of course is impacted right now by the number of staff who are furloughed because they have COVID. And that is before we take account of all of those healthcare workers who are also not able to be at work today because of other planned or unplanned leave. And I want to take this opportunity to thank them and thank all of the workers at the Children's Hospital who work so hard every day, extra shifts, whatever it takes, to deliver the care that children of Victoria deserve. Thank you.
On a supplementary question, the Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. It's the second time this circumstance has occurred at the Royal Children's with children and their parents waiting outside to be seen because of mismanagement by their government, the second time in just 2 weeks. One of the doctors present told patients last night the situation was the worst he'd seen in 20 years. Can the minister provide a guarantee to parents across Victoria that a situation like this with children unable to be seen by an emergency department won't happen again?
Minister for Health.
Thank you very much for that question, and I will make the point. I'm happy to make it. This is the most challenging circumstance our public health system has found itself in, and just like public health systems everywhere in Australia and all around the world, this is a once in 100 year event. The global pandemic continues. Those on the other side seem to have chosen to neglect that. But we haven't. We're acutely aware of the impact. Right now, there are more than 800 people in hospital with COVID. There are, as I've said, all the staff that are furloughed. Our system is under enormous pressure. But through all of that pressure, our government will continue to support our hard-working healthcare workers. We will stand by them and we will support them.
That's right. In a ministerial statement, I call the Minister for Health.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Speaker, I rise to update the House on how the Andrews Labor government is expanding our world-leading virtual emergency department to residential aged care facilities right across Victoria. And so this morning it was great to be with my good friend, the Minister for Ageing, and indeed with the Secretary of the Ambulance Union, Danny Hill, to hear firsthand how this initiative is ensuring that older Victorians get the care that they need without needing to go to hospital. And in doing so, this is helping to take the load off our busy EDs and freeing up our hardworking AMBOs so that they can get right back on the road. Supported by the extraordinary clinicians, including Dr. Lauren Scher at Northern Health, this service has already supported more than 28,000 Victorians to access the care they need while helping ease the load on our hospitals as they manage unprecedented demand. And now, between 80 and 100 aged care residents per day will be eligible to access this service, which means that they will be able to get the care that they need
in their home. This will avoid unnecessary transport to emergency departments, which of course is incredibly upsetting and uncomfortable for our older Victorians. We're focused on treating older Victorians with the care, respect and the dignity that they deserve. And this pathway, Speaker, is just one of the initiatives that's being delivered under our $162 million emergency response announcement, which the Premier and I made only last month, which is focused on supporting our emergency response through our ambulance and through our emergency departments. Speaker, innovations like this come when you listen to healthcare workers, which is what we've done. These are all initiatives that have been driven by our healthcare workers. Only the Andrews Labor government will back them in.
Yeah. Member for Euroa. No, yes.
The other one.
The other one. The member for Lowen.
My question is to the Minister for Ambulance Services. In round one of the Horsham District Football League, Kniver Leon football player Matt Tink suffered a fractured and dislocated hip. Matt was in intense pain, no pain relief was available on the ground, and it was clear urgent medical intervention was required. Despite Matt's critical situation, the first two calls to overworked 000 staff were dismissed as non-life-threatening and just a football injury. And twice urgent calls for an ambulance to be dispatched were rejected. It wasn't until a former lead nurse from Kniver Hospital called 000 sometime after the first call that an ambulance was finally dispatched, the third call to 000. Why are country ambulance resources so scarce that it takes three calls to 000 to get an ambulance dispatched in country Victoria?
Minister for Health.
Thanks very much, and I thank the member for Lowen for her question. I'll make a couple of points just to kind of provide some clarity for the member. So, Esther takes the call and then it is handed to Ambulance Victoria, who will triage the situation and will distribute resources as needed on any given day based on the acuity of the calls that are coming in. And these are decisions that are made by qualified clinicians, and they are best placed to make these decisions. Once again, can I acknowledge the discomfort that has been experienced by the person that you have referenced. I want to acknowledge that. But once again, under our government, we have invested in our paramedics. Back in 2014, we made a commitment to the people of Victoria that we would end the war on our paramedics. We have subsequently recruited more than 2,200 paramedics, and only last week I was out with the Premier welcoming the latest bunch of recruits, 157 of whom will be placed in rural and regional Victoria. Our ambulance services, just like our healthcare services, are impacted by COVID. So, once again, on any given day, there are paramedics who are unable to come to work. The call takers in Esther, our paramedics at secondary triage, the paramedics working now in virtual ED, and the paramedics out on the road are doing a fantastic job. They are working as hard as they can to deliver the emergency life-saving services that Victorians need. But tough decisions have to be made every single day, and that will be based on the acuity of the incident. I want to make that point that our government has continued to invest through the pandemic to ensure that we're giving Ambulance Victoria the resources it needs to deliver the very best care that it can. Of course, if the member for Lowen wants to share details with me of the person concerned, to enable my department to make contact with that person and seek their permission to find out more details, and I'm happy to do so.
Order. Order. Member for Eildon. Member for Lowen on a supplementary question.
Thank you, Speaker. It is now 16 weeks after his injury, yet Matt still doesn't have feeling or movement in his right foot and doesn't know if he ever will. Matt will never play football again, and his ability to return to full work capacity is doubtful because of the extended time his nerve was compressed while waiting for 000 to agree to send an urgently required ambulance. Can the Minister explain to Matt and other local footballers across the state...
Order. Member for Long will be heard in silence.
Can the Minister explain to Matt and other local footballers across the state why scarce resources have led to serious injuries now being assessed as not urgent and not requiring an ambulance if the injury occurs on a football ground?
Minister for Health.
I thank the Member for Lowen, and I make this point. I'm certainly not aware, and I suspect that this is not the case at all, that any such decision is made. That is simply nonsensical.
An injury is an injury,
and it is assessed on the basis or by a qualified clinician who will dispatch the appropriate care at the appropriate time.
I'm not a clinician, nor
do I believe is the member for Lowen. So she's got a lot of assumptions in the question that she asked. But as I said, I extend that
member
offer. If she wants to provide me with details, I'm happy to ask Ambulance Victoria to find out exactly what happened and to talk with Matt and to work with him. Thank you.
Order. On a Minister's statement, I call the Minister for Transport Infrastructure.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, Speaker, over the winter break, there was no break when it came to removing dangerous congested level crossings around the state. And recently I joined with the members for Tarneit and St Albans to mark the removal of the 65th level crossing at Fitzgerald Road in Ardeer. I'll come back to that number, Premier. Because, Speaker, in 2014, the House might recall that the Andrews Labor government promised to have 50 level crossings removed by the end of this year. Yet here we are, and 65 have already gone. Now, Speaker, some call doing more a blowout. Well, yes, we have blown out the number of level crossings we committed to remove this year, Speaker. And not only have we removed them ahead of schedule, we are under budget, with hundreds of millions of dollars being returned to the budget in May of this year. And as work winds down on one level crossing, it ramps right back up on another, Speaker. And I was very pleased to be in Croydon yesterday to see another dangerous and congested level crossing that's on its way to being gone at Coolstore Road. We are removing every level crossing on the Lilydale line, and with the recent removal of the nearby level crossing at Manchester Road, Moorabbin, the local community can see for their own eyes the benefit that it brings. And I know that people are looking forward to seeing the level crossing gone in the heart of Croydon. Speaker, we get on and do the hard work of planning and delivering projects. Victorians know that when we say we will do something, we do it. Others take a different approach. On Sunday morning, we opened our newspapers to read that some had proclaimed the East-West Link dead. By 6 o'clock that night, though, it had been resuscitated, Speaker. It feels like we are watching a rerun of Weekend at Bernie's, Speaker, with this project and with the Liberal Party, who just can't quite let it go while we get on and deliver the projects we're committed to.
Member for Frankston is warned. Call the member for Paran.
Thank you, Speaker. And my question is for the Minister for Planning. Minister, this week is Homelessness Week. Victoria is in a housing crisis. There's around 25,000 Victorians that are homeless any given night, 120,000 people on the public housing waiting list. Yet last week, the government finalised the planning scheme for the Arden Precinct that provides only an unenforceable, non-binding 6% target for affordable housing, despite the planning panel recommending it be mandatory, and no requirement for public housing to be built. Minister,
Given
the housing and homelessness crisis Victoria is facing, why is there no requirement for affordable or public housing to be built in such a significant development area?
Nice to see you still.
Order. I'll call the Minister for Planning when the House comes to order. Member for Richmond is warned. Minister.
Question, and I thank him for his interest in social and affordable housing. Certainly something that is very dear to my heart. When my own mother grew up in Housing Commission in West Heidelberg, I absolutely understand the importance of social housing, community housing, and ensuring that across our communities and across the precincts that we develop, that we have opportunities for social and affordable housing for our communities. And it's certainly disappointing that those opposite haven't put their own name to some of the reforms that we have sought to put forward to this end. So I do thank the member for Paran for his question. It is important that in all of our planning framework, in all of our decisions around planning strategy across our communities and across our projects, that we do make provisions for housing that suits the demographic, the needs and the various interests of communities. And we look forward to continuing to do that in the future.
And a supplementary question, the member for Paran.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, the only people who benefited from a decision not to have mandatory affordable housing or public housing in this development are the profits of property developers who are not required to give back to the community. Given that there are major developments right across this city, when will the government stop siding with the interests of property developers over people in need of a home and introduce mandatory requirements for affordable and social housing?
Minister for Housing will be heard in silence. Minister for Housing, Planning.
Thank you, Speaker, and again thank the member for Paran for his question and for his interest in affordable housing. It's a shame that he is ill-informed and simply wrong. There is a requirement for social housing, and it will continue. It will continue to be an important aspect of all decisions in relation to planning of new precincts around our community.
No Minister's statement. I call the Minister for Women.
Speaker, I rise to update the House on my attendance at the recent meeting of ministers from around Australia responsible for women and women's safety that was convened by the National Minister for Women, Katie Gallagher. At the meeting, I outlined for my federal and state counterparts the Andrews Labor government's commitment to address women's equality through economic and workforce participation. I'm extremely proud of this government's commitment to support women and our nation-leading Best Start, Best Life initiative, backed in by a $9 billion commitment. I have to share with the House that there was a lot of interest in this initiative at the meeting, including how we're working with the New South Wales government. The Andrews Labor government will deliver landmark reform to early childhood education and care with a massive $9 billion investment over the next decade to save families money and to support women in returning to the workforce. Whilst more dads are staying at home with the kids, it's still the mums who do the lion's share work of childcare. This initiative will make kinder free for every Victorian family and deliver a new year of universal pre-prep for four-year-olds across the state. It means next year, a family with either a three-year-old or a four-year-old, or in the case of the member for Northcote, she has both, a three and a four-year-old. These families will pay nothing for kinder, saving them thousands. And we're building 50 new low-cost government-operated childcare centres in childcare deserts across the state to ensure that regional parents don't have to travel long distances for a great start for their kids' lives. It's about creating opportunity and giving women the time and the freedom to pursue their own goals and their own ambitions. And speaking of giving women choices, this side of the House supports women to be able to access safe, legal and dignified reproductive choices, including abortion.
On a minister's statement, I call the minister for. That was close. Call the member for Lowen on the question.
Thank you very much, Speaker.
My question is to the Minister for Health.
Order, order. Member for Long.
It's wonderful to be here to ask this question to the Minister for Health. The elective surgery waiting list for last quarter was around 90,000. Reporting of this quarter's waiting list is now overdue for release. Why won't the Minister release the latest figures? Is it because the elective surgery waiting list now exceeds 100,000 Victorians?
Minister for Health.
Look, thanks very much, Speaker, and I thank the Member for Lowen for a question. Let's be clear, when the quarterly data is ready, when it's been collated, when it's been validated, it will be released, as is our normal practice. And of course, it is this government, and this government only, that sought to introduce and has introduced regular quarterly reporting, and we've provided real transparency when it comes to the performance of our health and ambulance systems. This, of course, is in complete contrast to those on the upper side, who have always worked to try and hide the information that is available. We, in contrast, have worked to make as much information, make it as transparent as possible. And so that's what we'll do. And the quarterly data will be reported when it is complete and ready to be made public.
Member for Lowen on a supplementary question.
Thank you, Speaker. Can the Minister advise why the elective surgery waiting list, now at record levels, amidst waiting list figures at some regional hospitals such as Mildura and Bairnsdale, despite Bairnsdale alone having a local wait list of around 1,400 people?
Minister for Health.
Thanks very much, Speaker, and I thank the Member for Lowen for her question. The planned surgery wait lists across Victoria are being actively managed every single day by our healthcare services, and indeed we are doing what we can to spread the load around the state and make sure that we can get as many additional Category 2 and Category 3 surgeries done as possible. It's important to point out at this stage that every Category 1 surgery is being delivered within clinically approved guidelines. So that is a very important fact that people need to know. So once again, I'll make the point that the impact on elective surgeries is a consequence of the unprecedented demand on our system caused by COVID. And if you want to do something to help our health workers, put a mask on in an indoor environment. That's what our health workers would ask that you do. That's one simple action you can take.
Minister's time has expired. On the Minister's statement, when the House comes to order, when the House comes to order. Member for Jembrook, Member for Warrandyte, Minister for Government Services, thank you for your patience.
Mr. Speaker, I rise to remind this chamber that Victoria's donation laws are the strictest and most transparent political donation disclosure laws in Australia. Reforms made to the Electoral Act back in 2018 ensure Victorians know who makes and receives political donations in real time. The Andrews Labor government effectively put an end to individuals and corporations' attempt to buy influence in Victorian politics. It was our government that championed these laws to ensure their passage, while the Coalition opposed them at every turn. And Speaker, I can tell you with great confidence that the reforms of 2018 have enhanced the integrity of the Victorian electoral system and established a new strict regime to regulate political expenditure and donations. The measures of these reforms are many. A disclosure and reporting scheme, a cap on donations, a ban on foreign donations, a cap on anonymous donations, annual returns required to the VEC, anti-avoidance offences carrying prison terms. And the ultimate effect of these reforms is to improve transparency. Victorians know who is donating whom, what to whom, and these reforms severely restrict the influence of private money in the political process, and that is how it should be. Every single step of the way of this reform path, those opposite opposed transparency and they opposed integrity. And we certainly know why they did so. What has been revealed this morning is the involvement of the Leader of the Opposition in a brazen attempt to circumvent the country's strictest donations laws to get an advantage at the next election. This person cannot be trusted. His whatever it takes approach to politics is a warrant to all...
Order. Member for Jembrook is warned. Member for Ripon on a point of order.
Question time is not an opportunity to attack the opposition. That includes ministerial statements.
I ask the minister to come back to his ministerial statement.
Michael's already done his point of order.
What has been revealed this morning is the involvement of the Leader of the Opposition in a brazen attempt to circumvent the country's strictest donations laws to get an advantage at the next election. This person cannot be trusted. His whatever-it-takes approach to politics is a warning to all to question his judgment and his ethics. What we have here, Speaker, is evidence of a scheme designed to donate to the Liberals through sham contracts. How many other sham contracts have the Leader of the Opposition procured to circumvent donations?
The Minister's time has expired. I ask members to come to order. Member for Brighton. Questions have now ended and we will now move to constituency questions.